Hello, everyone. I want to welcome you to the robotics final project presentations. And we have an exciting set of presentations today. A lot of artistic, sports, and one infant robot participating today. Anyway, it's going to be exciting. Again, to everyone who's presenting, you know, it's 20 minute time slot for everyone. And out of that, 15 minutes are reserved for your demo video and your presentation. And you should start by introducing yourself and then share your presentation and start with demo video and then go into presentation. And we'll keep 5 minutes for question and answer. But before we begin, we have some guests joining in and some have joined. And if there's any guests who would like to at least introduce yourself, say your name, your company, and the title, please go ahead.
I'll start. Hi, my name is Sam Angeluni. I'm a creative director and president of the Alumni Council at the College for Creative Studies and a founding member of the ARC team. Looking forward to it.
Thank you, Sam. And I think you'll enjoy the creativity also today.
I always do. Your students always deliver.
Thank you. Happy about that. Anybody else?
Yeah. Good evening. Joe Weidevin, Vice President of Customer Service for ABB in Auburn Hills.
Welcome back, Joe.
Thank you. I'm looking forward to it. And I'll apologize right now. I have to leave for a little bit at 8 o'clock. I'll be back as soon as I can, but I have to go prepare for my own Oakland University project that I have to give tomorrow in my economics class.
No problem. Anybody else? Okay. Well, I'm sure others will be joining soon. So we're going to start, so we stay on time. And our first group 11, and their project is a puzzle box solver robot. So group 11, please introduce yourself first without sharing the slide first so that we can see your full screen and then share your slides. Go ahead.
Okay. Hello, my name is Jordan Rebar.
My name's Anthony Menuno.
You're muted.
You're muted, Marissa.
I'm Marissa Medina.
And my name is Arald Bartolari. All right, begin.
Okay. Hi, everyone. We are Group 11, and today we will be presenting to you our Robo Puzzle Box Solver.
All righty. So on our left, we have our amazing TA. His name is Joe. I'm the girl to his right. My name's Marissa.
I'm behind Marissa. I'm Anthony.
I'm Jordan, right next to Anthony.
And I'm Arald, the furthest to the right. All right. Well, thank you, everyone, for the reiterations and representations. The whole scope of the project is to create a design that will interact with what we've learned from our course. This involves not only learning how the robot is programmed, but to teach ABB Industrial Robot how to unlock a series of boxes consisting of a variety of different types of locks. Each action requires the features of the robot, like the high-speed capabilities, endurance, and accuracy to be showcased.
Thank you.
All right, wonderful. So for the design of the project, we wanted a series of boxes that had unique locking mechanisms and that could fit inside one another, thus programming the robot to open every box to then reach for the lid inside the final box.
All right, so for forward and inverse kinematics, well, we used both in the creation of our project. We applied inverse kinematics whenever we programmed circular movements in the tool frame, such as when we unlocked the bolt locks, unlocked the key lock, and when we opened the lids of the boxes. We also used inverse kinematics when we programmed linear movements in the tool frame, such as when we aligned the gripper and tool into position in order to unlock the respective locks. We applied forward kinematics whenever we programmed joint movements in the world frame, such as when we moved the boxes from A to B positions and when we moved the gripper into its ready position to retrieve the tools from the toolbox. All right. Dynamics was taken into consideration when we increased and decreased the velocity, unlocked the cabinet lock of the second box, and when performing the task of opening lids. Velocity was taken into careful consideration in order to avoid breaking components and to ensure the robot maintained the most accuracy and precision while following predetermined paths. During the transaction of unlocking the second box, we broke about two keys by applying too much force and or too much concentric torque when inserting and rotating the key in the keyhole. However, we eventually learned from this and came up with the idea to use gravitational force to our advantage. We ended up using G-forces to unlock the key lock by releasing the gripper mid-rotation and just letting the key fall instead of applying more force to complete the rotation and unlock the lock. This worked out well and prevented us from breaking a third key. In addition to this, we also used G-force when opening the lids of the first box by letting the lids fall open once they were brought to a certain position. All right, many errors occurred that were a direct result from the assembling of each component along with the poor quality of material. We experienced many issues with the second box as our makeshift cabinet lock kept falling apart, causing the small box to open when it was picked up out of the big box. We also experienced many difficulties in making the third box as it was finalized with the wrong dimensions. We experienced many difficulties with the tool holder being made of cheap foam, which began to wear every time we pulled the key out of it, causing the key's position in the holder to change. Each time this happened, it messed up the key's orientation with respect to the gripping point. Therefore, we had to keep modifying each point according to the changed position of the key. Furthermore, many errors were produced with respect to the position of the small box while it was placed within the big box. Each time we tested the robot's movement of the big box to its final position, the small box would fall out of place. This caused us to have to manually move the small box and or modify the point in which the gripper gripped its handle several times. We also experienced a lot of singularity when trying to align the key to the keyhole of the second box. The limited space in the overall work area contributed to our multitude of issues as well. All right, many improvements were made to combat these errors though. When the small box kept opening due to the poor assembling of the modified cabinet lock, which more specifically involved an additional hook-like type mechanism, as you can see in the picture on this slide, we ended up applying duct tape to the end portion of the hooks, which allowed for better grip when they hooked together. This substantially reduced the amount of slippage between them and fixed the problem. Another improvement that was made allowed us to avoid the singularity points experienced with aligning the key with the key lock. This was done by using another box to elevate the second box to a reachable point of the robot. We also fixed the error of the small box moving out of position while placed within the big box by adding stoppers that created static force within the big box that kept the small box from moving out of place. Some improvements that could have been made were that we could have bought better and more compatible locks for boxes, as opposed to a cabinet lock, which functions with respect to a vertical retention, as well as possibly buying components made with higher grade materials. This would have spared us a lot of trips to Home Depot. In addition to this, we could have executed the assembling of each box a bit better by pre-planning their build using utility software such as CAD and or measuring dimensions more accurately. As for future improvements, we could use a higher degree of freedom robot that would allow for more dexterity and a larger workspace in order to avoid singularities. A larger work area would help to improve jogging and constraint errors as well, as it would allow for more space to position boxes and equipment. As I stated before, Better methods of testing and planning can be implemented in order to save time and money on future builds for projects of this kind. Now I'm going to pass it on to Errol to add to our list of errors and improvements.
All right. Well, thank you, Marissa. Well, when tackling this project, one aspect that needed a lot of thought and iteration was the tool end effector itself. Since the robot is so precise, anything that the robot interacts with needs to be just as precise as well. So the implementation of tool frames for each tool were created, but this didn't solve all the problems. These errors came from something else. Just to expand on the tool fixture, low compliance in the tool frame fixture allowed for degradation and wear over time as well. This led to the overall operation to not work and sometimes cause damage to the work environment if there was no safety catches. This low compliance allowed for low coefficient of friction in the tool being held by the fixture itself. Variations in position and slight orientation allowed for the key to break due to an offset axis and concentric torque when turning the key. Overall, the tool frame fixture was just as important as the robot and workspace environment. Now, in regards to the tooling and the lid improvements, we had a series of iterations for the 3D printed tool, as well as the key for the 3D printed tool. We had two major points of iteration, the increased leverage arm and the extrusion orientation process of the part, as you can see in the top right-hand corner of the screen. Since the 3D printer prints layer by layer, plane by plane, the orientation of where the force is exerted is quite important for the strength of the part. We had some parts break due to this reason. In regards to the key itself, we found out that the placement of the key is quite important for the robot to do its job flawlessly. We created a styrofoam tool fixture for not only the 3D printed tool, but as well as for the key itself. We wanted to take advantage of the robot's three-dimensional workspace since we're constrained with space. So we decided to mount the tool on the acrylic protection wall. In regards to the lid was originally designed to be part of a third box, which was 3D printed. This box was supposed to be inside the second box. Due to time constraints, we decided to go with a twist. The approach for the third box, if it were integrated, is for the aluminum tool to fit in, clamp down, and twist the lid off the box like a screw. A two-point vertical linear move with the tool end effector rotating a certain rotational velocity would be an approach for removing the lid to finalize the project showcase. Now on to Jordan about the advanced movements that were showcased.
Thank you, Errol. One of the very first obstacles we encountered that utilized an advanced movement was the two bolt locks. We had to use a circular maneuver in order to grab the bolt, rotate it 90 degrees in a clockwise and or counterclockwise rotation. The issue we came across trying to use a linear move on this was that the bolt continued to slip out of the gripper. So we asked our great TA Joe to find out how to do a circular motion. And as you saw, it was a success. In regards to the circular motion, this consisted of three points, a starting point, a midpoint, and an endpoint. A circular path is then created that goes through all three of those points. Now, another showcase maneuver was when we taught the robot to finesse through the very small work area after picking up the 3D printed tool. The movement where the robot spun around the styrofoam block was done to avoid a singularity we experienced beforehand when opening up the first box. Now, in order to maximize the work area, we needed the robot to move the first box over and out of the way. We had to do this to also avoid another singularity point and even more jogging constraints. Now, with the box over to the side, the robot has more freedom in its orientation when dealing with the first and even the second box. We had several ideas that were thrown out around about how to tackle the problem of unlatching the hasp from the staple and getting the first box open. The first one was to lift it up using the base frame, but the issue with this is that we would have too many points along the path and it would have been in a back and forth diagonal direction. So this proved to be inadequate. The second approach was to use the tool frame on an angle such that the robot moved in a single linear direction. But this actually snapped the 3D printed tool and ended our trials on that for the day, which also proved to be inadequate. Our third concept was to use what Joe had taught us on unlocking the bolts the day before. So we set a circular movement along the hasp and it worked beautifully. Next was to thread the hook through the staple and again worked without any errors. By then, we were able to confidently open the last half of the lid and finally get over one of our biggest obstacles. Now here, we have some snippets of our code and several commands that we use to program the robot. We have a move J, which is a joint move, which came into play whenever we needed a quick path from A to B. An example would be when the robot arm would move from the staple to the hook tool. This type of move was necessary so the gripper wouldn't clip parts of the box as it moves to the next spot and does so as quickly as possible. Now, move L was used whenever we needed the robot to follow a precise linear path, such as when we position the tool and key between the gripper, moving the bolt back to unlock the latch, or inserting the key. Move C movements were used anytime we needed the robot to follow an arc. This motion was required for any opening of the box lids, the removal of the hasp from the staple, and unlocking the bolt locks. The other functions we used were a set do gripper and reset do gripper to close and open up the claw gripper. We quickly realized that with every time we opened and closed the gripper, a wait time function was needed before and after to avoid the gripper from moving before the set reset function had a chance to act. Now, whenever we created a point, we also had to set certain settings for it, such as velocity, offset, and then the tool that we wanted to use, the tool frame. To maintain efficiency, the first thing we had to do was create a tool frame for the hook tool and the gripper. This helped the robot calculate inverse kinematics when using a move L or move C maneuver. We did this by teaching the robot four different orientations that the tool could be in: a forward, backward, left, and right orientation. This created the tool frame that was located at the tip of the 3D printed tool, allowing the robot to position itself in relation to the hook whenever we needed it. Now I'm going to go ahead and pass it off to Anthony.
Thanks. So as you can tell from the demonstration video, the overall project was a success. Whether or not that third box was fully completed and built, it still was able to solve the other puzzle boxes that we implemented within the two first boxes. And the project itself not only further proved just how precise and accurate the robot arms that we're dealing with are, but it also shows some difficulties such as joggings or singularities that can occur while working with these. So in conclusion, robots can in fact open boxes and locks. And then more realistic of a conclusion, the project itself was a wonderful experience for us to work hands-on with industrial robots and to see how they function. Some helpful information that was gained was knowing how to control a different range of motion, such as the curve motion, the linear motion, and even the joint motion, especially within the short time period that we were given to work on it. Initially, we thought that the project wouldn't take as long as it did, but we ended up using a lot of lab time. So with more time, I'm sure there's a bunch of different applications we could have used the robot arm for. And then it also helps understanding how impactful the tool design is, where every step of the project, we had to analyze different ways that we could implement a tool or something to complete the intended function. And then for future applications, if machine learning and machine vision were able to be implemented, it would be used for different product companies such as Amazon or even Apple, where a machine could scan a QR code within boxes and then possibly scan QR codes that are on products. And then from there, the robot would allocate the correct amount of space within each box. And then that would allow for the maximum amount of product to be allocated to each box. And then from there, you could ship more products rather than just putting stuff in a box, and it might have some wasted space, which would cut down on a lot of costs as well for each company. And then other future uses include interactive robots, such as aerospace robots and even Boston Dynamic robots. Machine vision would allow for robots to view and analyze different problems, whether it's a locking mechanism or debris that's found in outer space that hits a space station. If the robot goes out and uses machine vision and machine learning, it can reallocate where that debris is or where different locking mechanisms are to get past that obstacle. And then we also realized very quickly that a large part of the project was planning and also brainstorming prior to just trying to solve the issue that we presented. Furthering the idea that once more complex applications become relevant and there's more people working on a bigger project, that brainstorming and creating ideas is going to be more important. And this is a really good way to learn that. And then stay tuned for the next season of Boxes and Loxes and find out if Liddy will ever find his box. And then any questions or comments?
Good job, Group 11. Good demo, good presentation.
Thank you. Right.
Thank you.
Okay, guys, just for everybody's sake, because we're having echo here, if you keep your mics muted unless you're talking, I think it'll help out. And also, sometimes these videos don't come across really well, as you know, because of our connection. I have posted the link. You can watch these videos in full glory and beautiful sound on the YouTube channel, which I created. And everybody should have the link and go watch them. It's really fun to watch all these videos there. I also have the presentation video there, but all the project demos are also separately there. Anyway, so let's open up for questions. I know Joe will have some questions.
I just have a comment.
Go ahead.
You know, I'm not an engineer, as you know, Dr. Mirza, but I found this very, very interesting and very informative and very well documented. And, you know, the presentation was very slick. I think the video was a little long. I think you could have done that with some cuts and get the same idea across. But what I particularly liked in your presentation, you use the ABB orange, the same that's on the logo. And I think that's very good and brilliant branding. I like that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I don't know if that was intentional or not, but.
It was. Well, we did it and yeah. We realized that we did it and we're like, wow, that was a good job. We might as well just keep that.
That's good.
That's good. So, because the checks in the mail.
In order to sell your ideas, you know, you always need that extra effort. And I think that showed. Very good.
Thank you.
Okay, you got plus points for creativity there.
So a couple things from my viewpoint. I think it was really interesting to kind of show, you know, the 120 is a workhorse. It's a small robot that does a lot. And I think it was actually interesting to see you go through the struggles you had with the key and the breaking the key, because you know the robot will just keep going, right? And so I thought it was really interesting how you guys got around that. I liked the accuracy you use, because obviously the key can only get through a keyhole, and that's a pretty tight fit. Talk to me about, and I obviously you guys are doing this project, but you know, end of arm tools, have you thought about different ways to grip, to grip the little pieces that you had to grip? Was the idea of another end of arm tool with more delicate or smaller fingers in play? I mean, obviously you did it well here, but was there a thought on that?
Yeah, absolutely. You try to more or less mimic like the human finger to more or less approach these locks. Initially, the box that came with when we ordered it came with extremely tiny locks. And we tried to design a tool more or less that would fit very, very tiny, areas that would lock onto the lock and attach it. So there were major considerations, but we wanted to basically have a universal tool that was able to unlock the locks and open the lids and go forth from there.
Sure.
Yeah, I have to mention that one of the constraints I put on all the groups was that you cannot change the gripper on the robot. Because yeah, there are multiple groups who are working on the same robot, and if they change it, then they have to change it back, and it's a big hassle then. So they have to deal with this big gripper on the ABB robot to do all these delicate operations. But you guys did well, so good use of circular moves there, and you actually need a circular move, and it worked really well. So great job there.
The last thing I'll point out, and I think this is actually a pretty good idea for your futures in robotics, where I really liked how you grabbed the different tools for the different tasks that you needed. In the future, you'll be able to go to, you know, there are different companies out there that sell different parts for the robot. So you could get like a fast end of arm tool exchanger where you put an end of arm tool and quick disconnect, and you go pick up another one for the task that you have in multiple spots. So I think this was a good intro to the quick change that you'll eventually do when you have a robot doing multiple items.
Yeah, good point, Joe. And the last thing I would mention, I think we are almost out of time here, is that motions like you did, key insertion, very precise motion, and there is no room for error, or you know what happened, the key broke, right?
So several chips to Home Depot.
So this is where, you know, if you had some compliance in the tool built in, or pressure sensing, force sensing, that way the move itself, see, is the key perfectly aligned, and then insert it. Otherwise, if it's just inserting and you're off by a little bit, it's gonna break. So those are some of the things you watch out for when you have very tight tolerances and you have insertion contact happening there, right? But good job, you were able to do it, and that was a fun demo to watch also. All right, great job, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, let's move on to the next demo. And that is the baby bot, group number 12. Please first introduce yourself and then share the screen and demo and then presentation. Go ahead.
So I'll start us off. My name is Jonathan Williams.
Hi, I'm Brad Pfeiffer.
Hadil Paulos.
And I'm Danny Aku.
I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen. All right, and this is going to be our simulation video.
Jonathan, you're muted.
Can you guys?
You're still muted, Jonathan.
All right, I'll try to go through my phone.
No, no, so, we can hear you now.
All right. So this is our baby bot, or in other terms, a simple shape sorter bot. And again, my name is Jonathan Williams.
Brad Pfeiffer.
Eddie Paulus.
And Danny Aku.
So RoboDK and Tinkercad is used in this project. RoboDK is the simulation program that we used. One great feature is that we can implement CAD model into simulation. Tinkercad is used to design the CAD model. This project plays with different shapes, with different sizes of an object. We have 6 objects, 1 shape holder or house, and 5 shapes with different sizes. This project shows the ability or the robot ability to cope with different objects and actions. Next slide, please. So here are the objects that we used. We used ABB robot, 6 degree of freedom. We use the shape holder or the house of shapes, and also 5 unique shapes as shown in the picture. Next slide. Here is our robot. We used ABB robot, IRB120 with 6 degree of freedom. This robot is the latest addition to ABB 4th generation. It's also the smallest robot available in ABB. This robot is the most portable and easy to integrate. It can fit anywhere and at any angle. The weight of this robot is 25 kilogram, which make it easy to fit anywhere on the machine, at the top or anywhere. And the height of this robot is 700 millimeter. The IRB120 robot has horizontal reach of 580 millimeter and ability to reach 112 millimeter below its base, and it's very impact turning radius. And it also has open structure that is special adapted for flexible use. And now I'll hand it to Brad.
All right. Thank you, Hadil. So for our simulation project, we wanted to, I'm gonna go back a couple slides, accidentally double clicked. So the biggest thing, for our simulation project was that we wanted to use RoboDK. Biggest reason was because RoboDK is available for free if you provided you get the educational license. This program supports over 500 different robots from various manufacturers across the world. You can use simple pick and place robots to assembly robots to manufacturing robots. They even have clean room robots that are available that you can use and test with. Again, we chose this program because we can import CAD models. To design the CAD models, we actually used Tinkercad. It was an online program that was available. It was created by Autodesk. It's completely integrated into the web browser. So it was super lightweight. It was very easy to use. We exported the objects in the STL format. This is one of the common CAD file formats that RoboDK supports. It also supports a majority of the other standard ones from STP to IGS to OBJ files and more. For our project, we wanted to utilize the CAD software to model our shape mold or the house. We came up with several different names for it, as well as the shape objects themselves. So as far as it goes, like I said, with Tinkercad, it was an incredibly easy program to use. We designed the objects and we were able to import them right into RoboDK. And then from there, we were able to actually create and design a table to put all the parts on and work with the robot directly. So with the robot, excuse me. with the robot, we want to be able to utilize the gripper to be able to use several different types of movements to be able to pick up and move the shapes. We want to be precise and accurate when it comes to it because we need the shapes to be able to go directly into the shape mold. So as far as it goes, we have to rotate and So with this robot, the ideal goal, I apologize, I skipped this slide. The ideal goal is to move those shapes into that shape mold and completely
fill the house.
Exactly. Thank you, Brad. I apologize, guys. So again, we're going to fill the house with those correct shapes, and then we're going to take those shapes, and then we're going to neatly and accurately utilizing the robot and the gripper, line them back up on the side. So in the simulation video, you also noticed the gripper cam that we use to help better showcase how the gripper functions, and noticing like the different positions and the rotations that we had to use to be able to properly orient the shapes and get them into the house mold themselves. Next up, we'll have Danny discussing the different outputs and robot movements that we use to conduct the simulation.
All right, thank you, John. And I know sometimes sharing these, the slides covers up a bunch of your screen, so it's hard to look at things. But anyway, so for us, for our robot, there was essentially one simple output or two outputs in this case, essentially pick up the object, place it into the house or the shape sorter. And then once it was placed, we wanted to take those objects, put them back onto the table. So, you know, it's a pick and place operation in that sense. Next slide, please. And so how we went about doing this is we used a combination of J and L moves. And in the middle picture there, you see, for example, so we made a bunch of pick essentially programs and place programs. And in that middle picture, you see, for example, a pick square, where we set the reference frame of the square object as the active frame for that step. And then we use a J move to get the gripper aligned vertically with the object. And then we use sometimes one or two, in this case, two L moves to move down, rotate the gripper to align it with the stick where you pick it up. And then we essentially close the gripper so that we made a program for that as well. And then pick it back up with a move L as well. And then essentially it moves to a place program, which you can see an example of one on the left picture there. And it follows the same logic. We usually move with the move J to get in to align the object with its spot on the house. And then with the move L's, we're essentially rotating that object to get it aligned with the hole and then place it. And so really, you know, with that, we have a total of 21 programs to accomplish this, you know, back and forth of pick and place, then pick and place again. And you see a list of it right there on the right. We added a couple of pauses there just for effect to show the completed house. And then we also made a go home program, which is for safety. Essentially, once the robot was done, it placed it back into the safe position, the normal starting position. And we used the J move to do that as well. But again, it was, you know, mostly J moves. J moves to start each step, and then L moves for rotation and for linear movement. And that way we avoided any singularities that could arise.
And now with that, I will send it to Brad. He'll talk about some challenges and some implementation.
Thank you, Danny. A couple of the challenges we experienced, it was just time consuming. We painstakingly moved every single frame to be perfectly aligned with the handle of each object to make it simpler. RoboDK allows you to jog the robot right up to a part, you know, get it pretty close, and then use a function called get with robot, and the robot will get right over that frame. But the frame needs to be perfectly aligned with the object handle. So that was a little time consuming, but not too bad. And then getting the objects perfectly placed into the house, there's some clearance built in, but that took a minute, but overall not too bad. We had some gripper issues as well, just trying to figure out how to use the program really, and some tutorial videos cleared that up, and it was not too much of a big deal. We had some issues with the RoboDK trial. It doesn't allow you to save anything, but once we got our licensing issues resolved, which was very quick, we were off to the races and everything went pretty well. Next slide, please. And so some real world pick and place applications would be things that robots would be better for, or better than humans for, if objects are very heavy or things need to be done very precisely, repetitive tasks, humans get fatigued and they can't lift that much and they're not that precise. I actually have some robots at work. There's some very large KUKA robots at my work. We make fasteners and we have some very big machines, and these machines need to be loaded with dies, and the dies are just too heavy for humans to lift. Some of our machines have overhead cranes. Our operators use overhead cranes to load the dies, but we have some very large KUKA robots on our machines to load all the dies for the operator, and that's very helpful. That's something that would either take a lot of time or would be very strenuous for a human to do. Even with an overhead crane, you know, it would take some time to do. So robots are very good at this kind of thing. Next slide, please. So just some conclusions. RoboDK was a very good application for this. It was pretty user-friendly. All we had to do was, you know, go on the website and do a little bit of reading, and it was not that difficult to use. Tinkercad was very user-friendly, you know, in browser, CAD modeling. So that was a very good application for what we needed. And, you know, we just showcased the versatility and dexterity of, you know, robots. These type of things can be used across many, many different industries for many different things. The pick and place function is extremely versatile and definitely, I'd say, one of the most useful robot applications. Next slide, please. Any questions? Oh, I have one more thing. Special shout out to my kids and my wife for letting me use the kids. Thank you.
Thank you, Group 12. Good presentation there. Okay. Well, you guys were certainly going for the cuteness value in your demo video, right? You scored very high there.
Thank you.
And by the way, guys, when you're doing the demo, don't mute your mic because we didn't hear any sound. So if you're playing the video, you got to have your mic on also so everybody else can hear the sound. I know this is the online demons we have to deal with, right? But again, all these videos are will be available on that link, so you can go and see that with the sound. I know you had some baby sounds in it too.
Okay. I was going to say the cuteness factor would have went up like a few more levels with the sound on, for sure.
well, good thing then. Otherwise, we'll be just going, oh, and we'll forget about the robot.
Right.
Yeah. All right. Let's open up for questions. Any questions for group number 12? If not, then I have some questions here.
I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
I have a question now. If you were to, thank you. If you were to implement this on a real robot, what kind of complications do you think that you would have? And also, I don't know if you got a chance to do any an analysis on it. Last lecture, I mentioned something about like in the CAD world, everything is perfect. So what problems do you think that you would run into if you were to implement this on a real robot?
So I guess if I may, I did the CAT models. And so when I made the house, obviously we didn't actually print this, but I had in mind to essentially make the hole slightly bigger than the actual shapes, to just give us obviously some leeway. And obviously if this was actually, you know, if these objects were printed and we did this with an actual robot, that would give obviously some leeway there. As far as doing this with an actual robot and the challenges there, you know, I would say, you know, we picked obviously a robot that was a smaller robot. Because obviously for our application, we didn't need anything bigger than what we used. So obviously with having such a, you know, and then our model was technically was very small. I think the CAT models for the sizes, I think they were 10 to 20 millimeters each object. So they're tiny. And so I think, as some other groups have mentioned, obviously you would have to have a very fine gripper to make sure obviously things don't break, depending on the material obviously used for the item. And obviously, I think applying this on a real robot, the actual programming of it is probably a little bit tougher than doing it on a simulation, where you know you have to then use the pendant and all that. So, and one challenge we had, I thought, was also the aligning everything correctly because of the field of view, because obviously you try to get everything aligned correctly, but then you have the arm, you have the gripper, and obviously with the simulation software, I could just say don't make this thing visible. With the real robot, that's not an option, so it's going to be on all the time.
That was a very good question, Rami, and a good answer there, Danny. You know, most of the time, this is an important point here, most of the time when you're doing applications in industry, you're programming offline. That means you're using some kind of simulation tool and CAD models, and the models and everything are very precise, right? So everything is, when you design an application offline, is very precise. The problem is in the real world, is your real world an exact replica of your CAD model? Is your robot exactly in the same place relative to the part? You know, those are the questions which can never be 100% aligned, and the slightest rotation of the robot, a slightest tilt and this and that, and your entire application is not going to work. Which is why whenever complicated applications are taught offline, they're mostly taught offline using these tools, but then the programs are loaded on the robots. But before you can run the program, you go and test the points and tweak the frames. So you see the frames might not exactly be aligned. So you tweak them, the whole program shifts, right? So if they are slightly a millimeter out in one direction, they're off by a millimeter. When you adjust the frame back, everything gets aligned also. So that's an extra step you have to do going from a simulation to a real world. Unfortunately, this is how most of the time applications are done. Automotive applications, which have long lines of robots, they're all programmed offline. And then when you load the programs on the robots, you got to tweak the program so that everything is represents same as the CAD world, okay? So that's a good point. This is what you have to do. You don't have to reteach it. The program is there, the sequences are there, which work in the CAD, just to make sure that everything is in synchronous, you know, they're synchronized to your CAD model, or you make those tweaks. So one of the things you did, which is good, and I think the whole class should note, is that singularity avoidance between the moves, you were using joint motion. And the linear motions were simple, approach, and then putting in and taking the parts out. That's one good way to avoid singularities between the points, motion of the points. Another thing you could, you showed that you had a program with pick and place modules. So it's good to have modular programs. The one good way is to have index move also. So everything is relative to a part frame, and you say move 1, 2, 3. If they are regularly spaced, then you can just add dimension and the same move will work and it will go to a different spot based on how far apart that part is, right? So those are some ways you can make your program compact and kind of a iterative loop there. So there are ways in advanced programming. I mean, I didn't teach them because, you know, when you start doing actual programming is when you see how can you make your program more efficient and manageable and all that, when you have hundreds and thousands of points to deal with, right? Okay, any other questions for this group? All right, well, good job, guys. Okay, let's move on to group number 13. And we have the Bob Ross robot. So group 13, introduce yourself first before sharing the presentation, and then share the presentation, show the demo and the presentation itself. Go for it.
Hello, I'm Patty Hassa.
I'm Jason Dickey.
I am San Juan.
And I'm Alyssa Lefevre.
Patty, don't forget to unmute your mic. Sorry, Alyssa, whoever is joining.
Is my mic muted?
No, you're on.
Hello, I'm Bob Ross, and I'd like to welcome you. First of all, let me take just a moment to thank you for allowing me back into your homes. If this is your first time with us, let me extend a personal invitation for you to drag out your oil paints and paint along with us each week. Let's go over to the canvas here and let's get started. I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart. I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart. Let's build a happy little cloud. Let's build some happy little trees. There are no limits here. You start out by believing here. You can almost paint with anything. All you have to do is practice. There are no limits here. Believe
We chose the ABB robot because we found that controlling the robot with the joystick would be best for our application. The size of the robot and the size of its workspace allowed for a good application to recreate human-like painting techniques. Our idea was to recreate a Bob Ross painting. We, of course, had to simplify some of the painting techniques. So we decided to paint just the water, a tree, and mountains. For this, we use 4 different colors, black, white, green, and blue. And the purpose of this idea was to bring creativity to a robot application and have a robot paint as human-like as possible.
So for programming this robot, what we started off with was just a poster board with all the lines marked out for where we wanted the robot to move the tool. So each line there is based off of the width of the brush itself. So we have a different brush for each color paint. So we have a different brush for blue, green, black, and white. And each one of those, for the mountains, it's all off of the one brush. And then for the water, it's a 2-inch brush. Then for the tree, it's the spacing doesn't really matter because it's just the tree and there's no mistakes according to Bob Ross. So, and we're only using the tip of the brush. We're not using the faces or the sides of it. So the width and the spacing doesn't matter as much. And then we also had to account for some of the, at least as much as we knew, some of the techniques for painting and how you want to create what you're going through, referencing some of Bob Ross's own YouTube videos just for some ideas of how to create it. Next slide. So for this, we use 5 different coding commands. So the first one we use in this program is a move J function to move the robot tool above the paint brushes before it starts. Then we use move L continuously throughout the rest of the program to move linearly to move the brush or to change orientations of the tool itself. We also had to use a wait 5 function when picking up or releasing the brush itself, because the problem we had was the cursor would get too far ahead of the robot position and end up dropping the brush preemptively. Then we also use the UC function to create an arc, and how that would work was setting up a move L function to set the start position, then using move C to set a midpoint and a final point, and then the robot will trace an arc throughout space. And then we also had to use the set do function to open and close our gripper. Next slide.
This is a diagram of the steps our robot took. The steps are color-coded to which color the robot was working with, except for the first and the last steps. So as you can see, the robot starts with a brush unattached and makes its way to pick up the brush with the blue paint and paints the water. It then uses the brush with the black paint to paint the trunk of the tree, and then it uses green paint to paint the leaves of the tree. Next, the robot paints the black mountains and then the snow on the mountains with white paint. Lastly, the robot paints the surprise ending in black.
When we implemented the project, we met lots of challenges. Unlike to use a hand to paint, it is very hard to manipulate robot arms to grab brushes. To prevent brushes filming, we added tapes around for a tighter grip. To keep the brushes upright, we use a phone like the picture showed. To make sure the robot can pick up brushes precisely, the curves should be placed in the exact same position during each lap. As we cannot put our curves in the lap after we left, so we use tapes to mark curves position on the table. But the brushes may still in tilting the program. The second challenge is when brushes contacting with the paper, it is hard to control the force and orientation. So we adjusted the height of the paper to control the touching points. The amount of paint dips in brushes is also problematic. So we controlled the amount of the paint in cups, so the paints are not dips too much on brushes. Before the brushes leave cups, 3 second hot time is set to make sure the excess paints can draw back to cups rather than drop. Problem for our design. We solve this by reorienting the tool orientation and continuing on the same path in the word frame. Next slide, please.
So these were the results of our first run. In this run, we had a lot of paint in the cups, which resulted in too much paint being on the brushes, which in turn caused too much paint being distributed on the paper. The brush was also too high on some of the motions, so it didn't fully cause the brush stroke to go all the way across the paper, which is why there's so many gaps in the painting. Next slide. Next slide. And then the second results, we raised the brush about a centimeter higher and put the paint on the brushes ourselves. In this run, there was too much pressure on the brush, which caused the brush to twist in the gripper and obviously didn't give us the results of the painting we wanted. Next slide.
Go back a slide. All right, go ahead, Shannon.
Compared with the second result, we added more paints to the brush so we can see more outlines. But as it is hard to control the force and orientation, some parts are overlapped. Like the upper side, the white section should be the ice mountain, but it is overlapped with black. Next slide. And then after changing the height of the paper to the original position, we got the final result. Even it still has flaws, but compared with the previous, it has improved a lot. Next slide, please.
All right, so clearly there's a lot of improvements that can be made on the project overall. One of those is controlling the amount of paint being applied to the brush, either having a paintbrush with a hose attached to fill it with paint when it's needed. Also having a better tool to grab the brush, having a pincer move grab the brush, offered movement along the opposite axis of the paintbrush when we raised it. You can kind of see that in the video as well, when it's doing the final moves, that the brush tilts, having us to actually have to reset that. Another thing we would have to have is researching a little bit more on the different techniques and trying to expand our knowledge of how we would go about creating a better picture for it. Another thing we have to have is some force feedback. That's probably the biggest issue with trying to do the water, is that we're in contact with the page, but we're not applying enough force on it to get enough paint on that section. The other thing we could do is do a visual system where we can see where the brush is, because of that tilt, when any time the brush sets in the cup and it leans in any way because the foam isn't the proper size for the cup, having a visual system would allow us to exactly see where that tip of the brush is and allow the robot to grab it every time. Then if we want to go even further, being able to capture the motion of a person going through these motions and then translating it into code to the robot would probably be more expensive and the option, but maybe the most accurate in terms of creating the painting that you exactly want. All right, and next slide. All right, that's the end of our presentation. Anyone have any questions?
Good job, group number 13. Good demo, good presentation. Well, I have to say that that was fun to watch a robot paint and moves, the painting moves. It may look easy, but you know, having a natural painting motion, you guys nailed it. It did look like sort of baby Bob Ross, right? Learning to paint. But this when you painted that tree, you nailed Bob Ross technique there. So good job there. Anyway, let's open up for questions for group 13.
Is the yard hanging on your refrigerators?
It's actually sitting in my room right now. I told my mom that it would be an early Mother's Day present.
You should auction off the paintings made by robots. Definitely. Yes, more questions for them.
No, it's not so much a question, again, a comment, and that's something I guess I'll repeat. Nice job with the robot. You pick something that's pretty difficult, and it just reinforces that when you guys get into the business in your future careers here, so much is also dependent on not just what the robot does, right? So you got to make sure that your customer is giving you good drawings with accurate places to pick up. You know, we run into so many positions where a customer gives us something to look at in a vision, and the color they choose in their plastic doesn't work with vision, right? So there are so many things that go along with what you're trying to do with the robot. And I think this was a good illustration of it. I think it was really good.
Yes, thank you, Joe. So actually most robots paint using spray. So that's easy, easily programmed. You position it right, spray on, and you paint, right? You took the hard way of doing it. But the nice thing is that you learned a whole lot about the robot and different types of moves, joint, linear, circular moves. You mix them to make it look natural. So it's more about learning the robot hands-on, having fun with it, than the actual painting in reality. But you know, if you're painting like Bob Ross, then this is the only way to do it. No spray painting there. Any other questions for this group?
I do have a question. You think it's possible to like integrate some kind of brush that has a integrated set sensors that can tell you the orientation, the position, the vector, and the pressure, and you can have a human draw the picture, and it's recording, and it's giving feedback to the robot, and it's telling it where the position is, what the pressure is, how far is it out of the paper, and it's recording all these steps, and you know, playing it back and letting it do it by itself.
I didn't look too much into a more technical brush. I know that even if there wasn't the brush that had like all the feedback, using inverse kinematics and stuff by hand and doing the hand calculations or through force feedback, because even if the brush experiences force here, it's still experiencing the same force up here. So that can be translated through the robot code, even through that point, to give a feedback of where the brush is and what force is being applied to it.
So I should add there that you are working with a naturally compliant tool, you know, the brush, because of the end of the brush is compliant. So one way would be to use visual feedback here. You know, when you apply, you see, well, how does it look? And based on that, you do the stroke again, maybe a little more, just like a painter does, right? When you paint, you see, you're using your eyes to see how it's going, because it's, yes, there is pressure when you learn it with time when you're painting, but also a lot of visual feedback is what's the result? And so you can touch over and do it. So yeah, I mean, it's a very hard thing for a robot to do, but you know, that's that interesting creative ways to think about it if you wanna show it off. Maybe a brush has a paint feed in it. So it's feeding paint into the brush and it's painting, doesn't have to go dip it in. You guys did a good job for the tool design, you know, having way to pick up brushes, which is full of paint, and then put them back in the in a precise position, because it's all about that, right? I saw some creative editing there, so maybe you didn't pick up the brush in one shot, but that's happening because you have foam, which is not very precise. So those are something you may have to solve. Any other questions for this group?
One more thing, Professor, if I can just add, just to answer your question, yes, we are starting to learn how to do that. We do have a virtual tool that we don't necessarily use with our customers yet, but where we use glasses and we use VR tools to mimic what we want the robot to do, and the robot can repeat it. So we do that we can do it, especially, you know, just like you do here in paint. So when we paint a car, you can follow the movement, and then the robot will understand what you want and do the same thing. So again, we don't use it with customers. It takes a lot to set it up, and it's not worth the effort right now, but we're getting there.
Well, that's exciting.
And of course, you know, and of course we belong to ARC now, so that we can start doing that with everyone else. So we're getting
there. There you go. It's a mix of two fields there.
Yep.
Robots painting using augmented reality.
Yep.
Awesome.
World coming to, huh?
Yeah. Any last questions before we move on? All right, great job, group 13. Okay, two more groups to go. And now we have an athlete robot, robo athlete, group number 14. Start with introducing yourselves and then followed by sharing your screen for the demo and presentation. Go for it.
Hello, everybody. My name is Etienne Zeka.
I'm Rafael Sifo.
I'm Lana Fakori.
Hello, I'm Hui Tung Mu.
Okay. One second here. Okay. Does everybody see it?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, so this is the robo athlete. I'm going to go ahead and get into the demo.
Unmute your mic, Etienne. Can we start that over real quick?
Can we redo that real fast? I'm sorry. I have myself muted. Is that fine? Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Is it fine if I read it real fast, or?
Just repeat it real quick.
Repeat what? Just the introduction?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, play.
You guys ready? Okay. Okay. Okay, so sorry for the technical difficulties that the audio was having. Let me see this now. I don't know why. Okay, so going into the introduction, the idea behind the Robo Athlete was to design a robot that can shoot a ball into a basket and also showcase the possibilities of these robots. So as you saw, there was a basket. We had to basically pick up the ball at a proper spot and then have it make it in. To add, we only got to about 25% accuracy as far as making it in goes, but we had a good 90% accuracy of actually catching the ball and placing it in the placeholder, which you saw the bucket was. This was all done through the High Wander X arm, 6 degree of freedom robot arm.
Was to increase in performance, capabilities, and the overall efficiency of a manipulator.
Also, tasks are performed at a faster rate. This application could be useful for disaster sites, junkyards, assembly lines, construction sites, or for entertainment purposes. So typically robots are not allowed to have human interaction within the workspace for safety reasons. However, throwing and catching is a safe interaction method, and it can be used in theme parks, sports, or other entertainment that uses those sets of skills. As you guys will see now, we want to share with you a quick demo of a robot created by Toyota using the skills I mentioned to shoot hoops.
Give me one second, let me share that because it's popping up on a different screen. So let me do that really fast, I'm sorry. Here you are. So going into the design, now our robot isn't like you, we're not making it 100% of the time, but we try to make it the best way possible for the robot to have a good shot and actually get it into the ball or into the net. So to do that, we set up the balls precisely in front of it, and they had to be kind of like measured out, a little bit of trial and error. Because if you grab the ball at a specific spot and it's thrown, then you had issues of it either being thrown a little bit off or a little bit too close. So we try to avoid that by getting a pretty good sweet spot for where the robot can actually, you know, use its gripper and pick it up properly. Initially to start, yes.
Can you share your screen? You forgot to share your slide.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
And you have an echo, so I don't know why.
Oh man, having all types of issues.
Give me one sec, I'm sorry.
Okay. Better?
Yes.
Can you see that?
We can see it. Go ahead.
Hello?
Yes, we can see it. Go ahead.
Okay, you want me to repeat what I just said?
No, go ahead.
Okay, so basically, we had also set up the robot to shoot the ball into the basket without the backboard initially, just into the custom piping. With this, we saw a bunch of issues of overshoot where the ball was going over. So to design a simpler effect or a simple idea was, why not add a basketball net with the backboard to kind of cushion the blow of the ball and coddle it into the piping. Once it got into the piping was there as a design to delay the ball from going, you know, at the point of release to the point of exit to be picked up and then later distributed into the buckets below.
Some framework. For the framework of our project, we focused specifically on creating the trajectory path to resemble the realistic motion of properly shooting a basketball into a hoop, as displayed in the figure shown. To do this, we first created the desired trajectory path that the end effector of the robotic arm will follow for the throwing of the ball by simply just controlling the torque in each of the joints. We were able to create this path by manually manipulating each of the joints for each action and then recording them moving onto the WonderBot app. To ensure a better chance of accuracy, we place the ball, the basketball hoop, and the bucket and the designated area for the ball drop to be set up in like fixed positioning. This helped with keeping our focus strictly just on the speed for each action to improve the overall throw as well as the catch. We also included repetition of some of the actions to form a delay. And this was done at the end point of the throw so that the robotic arm would have a slight pause before moving to the next section of catching the ball. We noticed as we're doing the trials that the falling action after executing the throw would affect the outcome of it because of how sudden the motion was from one action to another. Next slide. Okay, so applied mathematics. While we did not solve any of the mathematical calculations for robotic application due to the restraint of not having the option to manually input the values for each of the joints, the torque of the joints and the trajectory path can be calculated to better the precision and accuracy of our application. And they can be solved through the use of dynamics and trajectory planning. The figure that we have displayed on the side is actually demonstrating projectile motion, which is applied to the basketball thrown in our application. This is also applicable in increasing the accuracy of your ball throw, such that if we have the ball thrown at an appropriate angle, its trajectory path will formulate into a similar arc pattern as displayed in the figure, and the ball falls straight through the hoop without the need of a backboard. Next slide, please. And then results. As you saw in the demonstration, we had multiple trials that we conducted throughout our project. Our final results came out to be a total of 18 actions. We were able to precisely throw and catch a ball in a single run, but we had extreme difficulties in getting the application to be repeatable. And this could possibly be due to the fact that our robotic application was shown to have such a low accuracy rate. The amount of joint movements that was kept at a minimal, especially for the movements involved in the throwing process, mostly because to achieve a smoother joint motion, we noticed that when we had multiple points within the trajectory path of the throw, it caused a lot of jerking in the joint movements, which affected the outcome of the throw. It also put a constraint on the velocity and the overall acceleration of the trajectory because of it constantly stopping at each point within that path. As you guys saw within the demo, if it wasn't too glitchy, the joints demonstrated a smoother motion when throwing the ball because it was held at a more conservative velocity along the path. And for the catch, while it would have been more amazing to see the robot use its claw to close on the ball mid drop to catch it, we just ended up using the tool to form like a cup lick holder to catch the ball, and it worked out just as great. Next slide.
The challenges in our project include manually create the robot actions like the positions, movement path, and speed, throwing and catching the different size ball, using the robot precisely to throw all the balls go through the hoop from the first throw, and adjusting multiple variables to properly perform the task. Next slide. The future directions are that, first, the robot can repeatedly throw and catch the balls. The second one is to work more on the precision and accuracy of the robot, such as using the vision sensors, optimize the movement path of the robot, or using dynamics to accurately determine the results of the throw to make in all shoots through the hoop. The third one is to catch the ball mid-air rather than forming a cap-like holder. Maybe it can be achieved by modeling the movement time of the ball and the movement speed of the robot. That's all of our presentation. Do you have any questions?
Good job, Group 14.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
All right. Well, I have to say, you're the first group which has sound effects. It sounded like you were in a big stadium.
I wish you guys watched the beginning of the video because the commentary was like perfect for the video. Unfortunately,
sorry about that.
Please watch the video. This is a common thing which happens when you do online stuff. So don't worry about it. Like I said, the links are available. Go see the demos in full glory there. All right, let's open up for questions for Group 14.
So, Professor, again, this is really cool to see, really fun. I know you guys did it as a project, but if you take notes, everyone write this down. Look up Andy Robot.
So I think it's AndyRobot. Okay. AndyRobot.com. He is a partner of ours. I mean, he works with us, or I should say we work with him when we get all kinds of crazy leads for interesting robots. Andy did this. This is his profession. He does really well at it. And I know, and go look up. He's got videos of using our robots and some of the other robots, but you know, shooting basketballs at halftime shows. I know that our robots at AVB are on the Royal Caribbean cruise lines doing TVs. They've been in Bon Jovi concerts, Lady Gaga concerts. But again, this is a great opportunity for you guys to see what else is out there in terms of robots and what your career can take you and all kinds of crazy ideas. So I think this is really cool. And it's real world application too.
Thanks, Joe. I appreciate that.
Thank you, Joe, for that tip. We're going to check it out. One thing your group must have observed, that accuracy in this, you had your mathematical analysis for the motion of the ball and all, and dynamics and all that, whatever. But accuracy is as good as all the links in the chain, okay? You started with a robot, a tabletop, which is not very accurate to start with, okay? Mm-hmm. And that's just, and the tool itself, how you grip the ball, it's not very accurate. So unfortunately, with this setup, you gotta just try, keep on trying, have some motion which will one time or another will succeed. If you start with a very accurate robot, a very accurate tool, how you grab the object and how you throw it, and what Joe was mentioning, that when you start with an industrial robot, which are very accurate, and then you start designing the motion, then you will achieve much better results. So, but I'm sure this was a great learning experience trying to do this, how to use, well, by the way, this is a 5 degree of freedom robot, not 6. So 6 degree is the gripper itself, which I don't consider a degree of freedom for the robot arm itself. But yes, so you have to keep that in mind, that everything has to be accurate for to achieve the final accuracy. One question I have is, why do you think the repeatability wasn't good for when you did this application?
I think it's more so due to like the outside variables that we have to take into account, because it's very unpredictable and how you would grab the ball, and you know, there's so many things you have to take into account, such as gravity, air resistance, and the grip of the ball also played a big factor. So I'm not really so sure what it was, but I'm pretty sure it's about a lot of those variables that definitely took a play into it.
Yep, all those things do factor in and they add up, right? So it destroys your repeatability and accuracy. All right. Any other questions for this group? Now, you will appreciate humans. I mean, that Toyota robot with AI throwing balls, 100% accuracy, move the robot slightly. It's all gone.
That was a person in a suit.
What?
No.
I don't know. I mean, they have robots, but it's how well that robot is calibrated with the hoop and everything. You got to do the homework before the robot can do 100% job. This should give you, you know, when humans throw the ball, they are running and then they throw and they're that good. So that's a talent, that's skill. Mm-hmm. So hopefully someday robots will come close, but again, that's a very high bar for robots also.
For sure.
All right, any last questions for group 14? Okay, we have our last project and now we are going into music. Robot Drummer is coming, group 15. Please introduce yourself first and then show the demo. Make sure your mic is unmuted when you show, because we have to hear the sound, right? Drumming going on, and then show your presentation. Go for it. Don't share your screen first, but first introduce yourselves.
Hey everyone, I'm Josh Arnott. I'm from group 15.
I'm Stephen Hooper. Am I sharing the correct screen or is it?
Yep.
Okay, sorry. It's showing up on a different screen. I'm Stephen Hooper.
I'm Austin Nolan. Usama Buna.
We'll start off with the project demo video.
What? I got a fever. And the only prescription is more cowbell.
All right, to introduce our project, we wanted to give an overview of our goals that we had. Our first goal was to develop a drumming demo that utilized the project robot that we were provided. Another goal was to get the robot to play some sort of rhythm in the demo, and then also to utilize different methods of striking the drums to demonstrate the functionality of the robot. And then another goal was to hit different surfaces, including drums and a cowbell. Then on the next slide. The video shows an initial test that we did with the robot. So to get to this point, we had to develop a tool because we weren't able to actually grip the drumstick. But we also realized that we needed to make some key improvements to help the demo go better. First, we needed to pick up the tool from a set location. As you can see, we kind of had to help it to grab it. And we also learned that we needed to fasten the robot down. You can see in the video that someone's holding it down because as it would pick it up and try and strike the drum, it would actually like tip over, or when it would pick it up, it would fly back. So we learned that. We also learned a lot about the pathways and speed control, because if we made the motion too fast, it wouldn't complete the strike before it would pick the stick back up. So it wouldn't actually hit the drum. And we found that the grip of the tool posed a lot of problems. So we tried a different method, using the other rotation to strike the drum as well. It really highlighted a lot of the challenges. These initial tests really highlighted a lot of the challenges that we were going to face as we continue with the project. Next up, we got Stephen talking about the gripper tool development.
Stephen, you're right, muted.
All right, sorry about that. So like Jason touched on, we had a bit of a progression with the tooling for this. The initial point, you know, initially we just tried to use a drumstick, try to keep it simple. The tool with the this factory grippers just didn't quite have the dexterity to hold the drumstick, to maintain a hold on the drumstick, especially with all the movement and the percussion. Would knock it loose. So we initially tried to make a tool with a straight out drumstick. And then we also put slightly larger blocks on the top and bottom, kind of as like a safety catch, because the tool, the gripper was still kind of sliding back and forth. So that would kind of was like a safety catch on that. And it worked fairly well. The movement of the robot involved using a lot of the joints, and it really taxed the motors, it seemed like. So we tried making a slightly different tool. The one on the bottom right, you can see where the drumstick is kind of perpendicular and goes out to the side. That would let us get the robot in position and then only have to use servo 5 or joint 5 in order to strike. And that would give us a little bit less movement in the robot arm, but we couldn't quite get the percussive sound to be quite right. So we ended up using the initial or the first tool that we made. And if we were using like a proper industrial robot, we could probably have Seguin or a pneumatic quick exchange, I guess would be the more common term for that. Or, you know, if you have like some sort of suction device, you have a negative air pressure that you can use for that as well. And then the next slide, we have the other challenges we dealt with was because it's just kind of like a suction cup for the base, it's not very fixed. We kept running into the issue of the robot would shift a hair and then that would throw all of our programming off because we couldn't get the marks to be quite precise. So we ended up making a small platform and I just bolted it down at 8 different points the way you would have it in a factory. You'd have it welded to a base or you'd have it anchored to the floor, so that your repeatability is very precise. You're not having to like reprogram it if the robot shifts a hair. And that really helped. And then in the video, if you saw with the initial one, we would kind of have to hand the tool to the robot to get it to grip it, because when it would drop it, it wasn't very precise or accurate. It had between like a 0.5 and 2 centimeter range where it would drop it. So I fashioned kind of a pedestal that let the tool just drop into the same place, kind of letting gravity do the work to help us with the repeatability. And it worked pretty good with both tools. So that kind of fixed the problem. I mean, if we were going to use like a full scale robot, we'd have, you know, a tool pedestal for it as well, just to kind of keep the tool safe from other traffic in the area, as well as, you know, just having it in the same position so that the robot, when it had the call function, could go to that spot. And up next is up next is Austin.
Okay, so we went through and did the forward kinematics for this robot. So a little bit more about the X-Arm. It is a 5 degree of freedom robot with all Revolute joints. And then in the figure below, you can kind of see the dimensions. And that upright position that it's in, you can kind of consider that the zero position for all joint angles. So on the left, we assigned a frame for each joint following Dennevit-Hartenberg convention for link frame attachment procedure. And then in the table, we have four parameters that describe position and orientation of each frame. And in the next slide, we'll use that those parameters to help derive our A matrices. So at the top there is our homogeneous transform matrix formula, which we use to derive the A matrices. So basically what we're showing here is the homogeneous transform between each frame relative to the previous frame, or frame I minus one to frame I. Next slide. And then finally, we multiply each A matrix together to get the position and orientation of the base frame to frame five. And this is kind of just to show what we've learned in this class, you know, applied to a real robot. So if we took every point that we programmed on our robot and plugged it into this, we would be able to show the position and orientation of each point in Cartesian space. And up next is going to be Wissam to talk about real world applications.
Okay, thank you, Austin. Atomic demo like this would likely be used by a robotic company to show off functionally of the robot in the fun way that could sell their products. Interesting demo like this can change with and get more views for robotic company online. Examples for this more engaging demo can be viewed in the picture below from ABB and Boston Dynamic. Finally, with this robotic able to product in fun and interesting way, the audience would be interested on how everything works, and this would increase the sales of companies. Next slide, please. Now we're going to talk about the conclusion. The goal we had for this X arm was to get a rhythm going using the arm. Listening closely to the video, you can see we have accomplished that. The arm played a rhythm in the end of dimension. Another goal was to have the robot starting at different patterns and dynamic, which was dimensioned by the video. At the start, it was a slower beat, not too fast and not too slow. Towards the end of the video, the drumming was somewhat fast-paced, heading at different space and rhythms. The last goal we had was for the robot to hit different surfaces such as a cobol and drums. And then it was accomplished in the very last clip showing that the robot hit the cobalt and the drums, the sum go. This means that accomplish our goal. Overall, we accomplished the goals we had in this device with a few and change can be evolutionary, which would create many different end outcomes for the world. Thank you. Next slide, questions.
All right, group number 15. Good job. I should be drumming at the end. Well, you know, your robot reminded me of my son when he was young. Even now, some of these days. Let's open up for questions for group number 15. Any questions for them? You know, one of the things is that it's not easy. You know, drumming is very human thing here. You know, the way you have to hold the stick and hit it and control the everything about drumming. It's a very tough challenge. And especially if you wanna have a fast rhythm going, the robot has to be extremely fast. Maybe one way is to have two sticks on the tool and you kind of vibrate it on the drum, something like that. So you have to come up with some creative ways. But I know there was a very short time and your robot was had limited capabilities. All right. Any questions for them? Nobody enjoyed the drumming?
You guys are making me feel old. I'm wondering how many of you guys were actually alive from that Will Ferrell skit from SNL in 2000.
All right, let's not date ourselves there. Yes. Okay. Well, one other thing is that you learned all the basic robot application techniques while doing it. As you found out that the robot has to be very firmly placed. It cannot be like dancing around. It's the workspace and you can expect it to perform repeatedly. It needs to be firmly planted wherever it is, and that the tool has to be located very precisely for it to go and pick up and use it over and over and over again. So those are some of the basic things you have to know, you have to think about whenever you're doing a robot application, especially if you don't have vision. If you have vision, yeah, then the robot can be mobile, can look and pick up wherever the thing is. You guys did the full kinematic analysis, which is nice. Okay, brownie points there. Did you use it? Did your group use the results, what you got from your kinematics?
We did the joint control from the computer application to get it to work, if we're being honest. I could lie to you. I could try and lie, but that's
not. Oh, okay. Well, no, I mean, I'm glad you did. That's a good practice. It'll help you prepare for finals also, which are coming up soon. One of the things you might have noticed that for this kind of application, you need very high acceleration. You know, if you're doing a flicking motion, you need very high acceleration and you have to go with the robot capability. I did show you a video about the KUKA robot drumming, right? In one of those lectures. And those are industrial robots. Most industrial robots do have pretty good capability here where you can use these robots for these applications. So yeah, definitely it's a fun thing. Robots are very much into entertainment area. You know, there's a big use of robots in all kinds of entertainment activities. So they are not just in the factories anymore. So some of you may be going in robotics field in entertainment area, movie industry, even music industry, with a robot band there going. Anyway, any last questions for the group?
Nice job for everybody.
Yes, I would second that. All of you guys did very fun demos today. And again, I would remind everybody to go see the actual demo videos without any hiccups and all. All right. So next, last presentation, we have four more groups on Wednesday, our last four groups, so don't miss that. And this will wrap up our very fun project. I'm really proud of all of you. I mean, you guys did come up with some very creative and fun projects and you made them work. That's the bottom line. Everything was working. So this is what I'm looking, that there are challenges. It's not perfect, but that's not the point. The point is to try to make it work the best you can within the limited time. And you guys did it. So kudos to that. All right, everyone. Thank you for joining. And guests, thank you for joining again. We hope to see you at our last presentation also. Have a great evening, guys.
Thank you.
One last kudos.
Good evening, Professor.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, everybody, for your time. Thank you, Professor.